Hello again and welcome to Manch Talk. I am Tammy Simmons Garthwaite.
And I'm Carla Garrick.
And we took a little break. Carla went on vacation.
I did. I had a great time in Costa Rica, right? Which I learned is not Costa Rica, which is how I've always said it, but it's actually Costa Rica. So I feel like I learned something new. It was nice. It's their rainy season.
Yeah, I was going to say, that's the problem with, I've been trying to book a vacation for 2 weeks, and everything I'm looking at, I'm like, it's still going to be in the 60s. I'm not spending that much money to be in the 60s. So.
I mean, it was nice because, and honestly, I mean, our friends have an incredible pad. It's at the top of the hill. It looks out. You can see sunrise on this side, sunset on that side, infinity pool. The kids are surfing. We had great noshes. Yep. It was really nice. But honestly, I'm happy to be home. Yeah. I even the cold, dark, bleak New Hampshire winter.
It's still
I was
nice.
Like, you know, first of all, I actually am starting to appreciate the cold.
Do you appreciate the cold, or is it more of a change of season thing, do you think?
Well, two things. One is, half jokingly yesterday, I was talking to a reporter and I said, well, you know, if our future is going to move towards a sort of lockdown model, then I think it does really matter where you live. And I choose to live in a place where my environment actually changes four times a year.
Yep.
I think that the seasons are actually very aligned with our own natural human rhythms, right?
I agree. Because I've lived in California, and it was very weird and disorientating that it just like
all the time
merges into each other, and you never get that refreshment.
Right.
Spring is spring comes and we're all like,
yeah, you feel rejuvenated. Winter is a great time for some nesting, maybe for some self-reflection, to really go. I mean, I'm working on all my lists right now of what did I accomplish this year? Yeah. Did I accomplish anything that was on the list from last year? What could I be doing better? Yeah. What do I want to accomplish in 2023? So I really love this time of year. It was nice to get away. We even did like a traditional little, we're not sure it was an actual turkey.
It was a bird.
It was some kind of bird, but we brined it and it was delicious, and we did
That's good. The yams
and the green beans and it, you know, all in bathing suits, and it was fun. It was good to get away. But it's better to be back.
So it's funny, I made a list and then Carla comes and we're both had the same idea. So there's a theme here. So I'm gonna jump to, if you haven't noticed, because if you haven't noticed, you're not paying attention to anything. There is definitely bias in the information that's being given to you.
No.
I know, it's a shock. But I mean, it is really becoming blatantly apparent. And it's not just, like, this all come up this week in particular because of Elon Musk releasing legitimate emails within the Twitter corporation. That show that they did intentionally censor information prior to the 2020 election.
So just for folks back home, if you're not following this 100%, basically what happened was, remember Hunter Biden's laptop, the laptop from hell, the one that has photos of him with clearly underage people, crackpots, drugs, but also the laptop has a lot of emails that are very incriminating for the then vice president, now president of the freest nation on earth, or so we claim, and it all relates, or primarily relates, to the Ukraine, to the energy markets, and so, you know, just anyone looking from kind of like a high level has to look at this pile of and go, there are some there. So finally, and the reason I take this so personally is it was the first time that I got like hardcore censored, where I was just like, oh, here's an interesting story. This is salacious. Yes, I will share.
Shh, no talking
and then,
for you.
Yeah.
And, that's what and, it was. I mean, that's literally how it was. Like, we don't like, we don't like your opinion. You're censored.
Right.
We don't like your opinion. You're censored. So
and so, so Elon, hopefully the hero for free speech, we're going to see, but it seems like he's trying and no one's perfect, right? Then went, they looked at the files, they took the back end of what was happening and gave it to reporters, primarily Tahibi, right?
Yeah, is Matt Tahibi and Tahibi so and I can't think of the woman's
name. He was a freelance writer. He wrote a lot for like Rolling Stones, mm-hmm. I think some Vanity Fair. Certainly a credible journalist. And he came out with the initial Twitter files. Yep. And basically what it shows unequivocally with evidence is that the Democratic Party contacted Twitter on numerous occasions and literally said, take down these tweets with these URLs.
Yeah.
And Twitter would take them down and say handled. And so this is collusion between big government and big tech to protect corrupt, immoral, evil people.
So that is what's triggering this in me now, right? So just a little side note, because Dan always gets these weird little, you know, he always has this little data points. So how much time do you think the four major news networks this past weekend spent cumulative on Sunday morning
on this issue? I happen to know that it was 7 seconds
between four networks on a story that is, this is news. So...
Oh, and actually, because the press secretary, Kareem
Jean-Pierre.
She actually yesterday was like, I don't know why we're spending time on this. This is old news.
This is old news.
And I was like, wow, watch them spin.
So you think about that. Just keep all that, like, they did. Twitter was doing this, and then now the new, now that Twitter's showing, hey, this is what really happened, the news isn't covering what we're finding out. And then you just open the union leader, and it's one thing after another after another. So on today's union leader,
so there's it starts an article with inflation begins to ease.
Right, and I'm like, what?
Which is like...
Well, and literally just yesterday...
Oh, boy.
We're literally, I'm in the grocery store. This was... Is this Sunday? No, was today's paper. So I went to the grocery store yesterday, right? I go to the grocery store all the time, right? That's how we shop. But anyways... Back at after the election, I did consciously note how much eggs were and different things because I was going to do a week-to-week thing, and then I said, oh, screw it, whatever. But I do have a point. So 3 weeks ago, egg prices yesterday in Market Basket were $4.79 a dozen, which is appalling. So now it costs $9 to get a pound of butter and a dozen eggs. That's insane. So I had this in my head, and then I open the union leader, and it says inflation begins to ease. And I'm thinking, what world are you people living in? And in this article, first of all, I'm going to sidetrack because they want you to think inflation is easing because that is what they want you to think. So we're back to that bias. They're feeding you what they want you to believe. Because if you go back to Snopes and everything, back in October, just before the election, Joe Biden claimed that today the most common price of gas in America is $3.39, which is down from over $5 when I took office, which is simply not true at all. Gas prices when Biden took office were like $2.39, not $5. They are still a dollar below where we are now when we're supposed to feel wonderful that inflation's over because... You know, eggs are $4.79, but we should feel good that gas is only $3.29 a gallon. And in this article, the things they talk about, that chicken's cheaper, and I have noticed that chicken's gotten a little cheaper.
So,
but how is chicken cheaper and eggs are so freaking still expensive?
It's, who knows, but talking about how we're manipulated and the sort of spin from the media and the tools they use to really, I mean, they're propaganda tools, but like one good example here is they'll say things like the consumption expenditure index posted its smallest increase,
right,
monthly increase since September of last year.
Right, so it's so smallest they take increase.
And they're like, so
a small increase somehow means decrease. That's not real. It's not real.
No, but it's important to understand and to see those tricks so that you're not manipulated.
Even in the picture. So there's one picture that shows $3.21 gas price, which conveniently has an oil truck behind it. So they're telling people, you know, like subliminally, look, the prices of your heating your house are lower. Mm-hmm. Yeah, talk to people who are buying heating oil at almost $6 a gallon.
I'm too scared to even look at that.
And then there's another picture of an Amazon box, right? And I thought, well, what's that got to do with any of this? You're talking about chicken prices and gas prices, but there's a picture of an Amazon box because subliminally it's like, look, everything's cheaper now.
Yep.
There's nothing in this article about Amazon. The reason people, I think, are shopping so much on Amazon is because they have to find the cheapest price.
Well, I think
it's... And they can't afford to drive because gas is out. Like, everything's so expensive that people are still buying things. I think it's hurting local businesses more than ever because you're going to go on Amazon and find it because it's $3 less and I don't have to drive 20 minutes to
get
to it.
Right. And it's so nuts. So do remember, I mean, support your local businesses. Make sure you go out for a dinner to, you know, tip your servers well. It's Christmas time.
So the other little weird media bias, don't really understand what the hell is going on in the world anymore.
We're going to do it again. I'm going to let you zoom in. Oh.
On the front page, there's an article about there's a Bitcoin involving Ian Freeman or whatever, and I think Ian Freeman is a registered Republican. I think he ran for office. I don't even know, right? But it has to do with money laundering, cryptocurrency, and whatever. It's what it's about is irrelevant.
Well, just to also put it in context, those are the federal states charges. Right. Basically, what it is it's a federal persecution of liberty activists in New Hampshire who are crypto forward, meaning we are trying to provide you and all our fellow Granite Staters with options to circumvent things like the inflation, which is caused by the federal government because they printed too much money. That's why we have inflation. It's not corporate greed. It is literally we've put too much dollars in circulation, and any person can understand when you do too much, you dilute the value, and that is what we're seeing.
Sorry.
Go ahead.
So in this article, which is about that, and I'm sorry, I used to really like Mark Hayward at the Union Leader a lot more. I used to think he was a lot more open-minded and not biased. And I really appreciate that in any reporter because, you know, that's not an easy job. But in this article, which is about Bitcoin and this federal case against somebody, and while Freeman espouses views that are critical of the government, he does not advocate for violence and has never been charged with anything in connection with the January 6th insurrection.
What?
What does the January 6th... whatever.
That's it's not a literal sentence that from the sentence. Article.
But I thought, what does this have to do with anything? So wait, because he's a registered Republican, now every time we talk about something. Yeah. So, but Carla, we had chicken for dinner the other night, and I was not charged with anything to do with the January 6th insurrection.
I mean, honestly, it sounds ludicrous, but that is
insane.
I see that in articles.
Why is that in there? This stuff. Is what the media... So this article, which is about a Republican, a registered Republican, involved with something to do with cryptocurrency, if you have no other idea, right? Somehow we slid in...
January 6th insurrection,
which has absolutely nothing to do with anything.
So the other thing that struck me in that same article, I'm just going to read the whole paragraph because I was like, none of this makes sense either. So this paragraph says, and to be fair, actually, to Mark Hayward, I think Mark, you know, does his best. It's a hard job. And I did think the cute little photo of Ian was, that was probably a choice. So, you know, maybe he's just trying to document what's happening. But for folks who are interested, jury selection is starting
today.
This morning, and they assume that the
arguments
will start today, and it's probably going to be a 2 or 3 week trial. And I don't know, juries and crypto, I'm a little worried. But so this article, this paragraph says, now cryptocurrency has plummeted in value, the FTX crypto exchange has collapsed, and congressional hearings and court trials have shown the ugly side of right-wing groups that decide to take the law into their own hands.
I don't even know what any of that means.
And then
I mean,
it said David Vinciato, a Manchester lawyer and former federal prosecutor. Yep. So there's the tell when you're like, who is saying this and what are they saying? And is what they're saying actually relevant to the facts of the matter? Now, I don't know why right-wing groups that decided to take laws into their own hands has anything to do with anything. And I can assure you, I personally know Ian Freeman. He's not really right-wing. You know what I'm saying? So, like, even the moniker, you're like, but you're talking nonsense.
He definitely wasn't a Trump supporter.
No.
So why would he have even been in, had anything to, just nuts.
And but the whole right-wing thing, you know, it's just like, you know, right-wing extremism, right-wing violence. Like, you see the word violence attached to right-wing all the time. And I'm like, well, what is the violence? Yeah. You're just saying words and putting them together in a way to create a neural programming to indoctrinate people.
If we just keep repeating that there's right-wing violence, eventually people think there's right-wing violence. So,
anywho.
So then on to something cheery. Ha, ha, ha. So over the weekend... Dan and I, it was Saturday because I remember I was trying to place like what day was it? It was Saturday because it was the day of the Christmas parade because I remember it was raining and I thought, oh, that stinks. So Dan and I were headed over to Queen City Ace Hardware over on Hanover Street. So Dan does this thing and we drive by and we have a little path that we take now just because you want to see like where the homeless are because it doesn't ever change. So it's out of control. And I'm sorry, people who live in the city should be outraged. Not that the fact that these people aren't being taken care of, that people are choosing to live this way and that it's become turning into a what our city is. So Kyle's going to run a little video. This is from Saturday afternoon over near the homeless shelter. And just look at this is coming up Pine Street, I guess. And this is literally what is acceptable in Manchester now to have tent city. Tent after tent after tent after tent. The reality is that I drove by today and there are more. There is more on the opposite side of the street. There are people living in what used to be the bus station. They're living in the outside of that. There is a whole bunch of people that seem to be camped out in what used to be the Chateau restaurant. I mean, this is literally outside of New Horizons.
Yeah.
So I find it outrageous that people are expected to just be okay with this being the quality of life here in Manchester. And it's not that I don't have compassion for people, because trust me, I do. And Carla and I talk about this a lot. But the reality is there was an article in the paper the other day again, and they're talking about like, oh, these people on the sidewalk. And they're saying, one, that it's okay to tent on the sidewalk as long as you allow passage. So 1 foot of the sidewalk is sufficient for somebody to walk by. Who in their right mind would walk by that? I don't know.
That's but, also like pretty narrow.
You know, definitely for not somebody in a wheelchair.
But also just in general, I mean, I don't necessarily even feel safe around this element because the last three murders in our city were literally homeless people stabbing old men.
The article had a picture of a girl, and I'm thinking this girl was somewhere between 20 and 30 years old, maybe. And she's fixing the tarp over her tent outside of what you just saw. And I thought to myself, why is she living on the sidewalk outside of New Horizons? She's obviously able-bodied. She could choose to live someplace where she does not have to live. People say, oh, but we don't have affordable housing. You're right. New Hampshire has limited affordable housing. Manchester definitely has limited affordable housing. But here's the reality. If you live someplace where you can't afford to have a roof over your head, you need to choose to live someplace where you can. These are choices that adults have to make in life. I grew up in upstate New York. I chose to move to New Hampshire because there were three sections of want ads and I could get a job in a day. Or I could have stayed in upstate New York and had to be on unemployment and took in some crappy job. I made a choice to move. People can choose not to live on the street. They can make choices. If you're addicted to drugs, you can choose to get help. If you have mental illness, I really have compassion and for the people who are truly like not able to care for themselves. But though that's where I think our funds need to focus on, like the people who are, and anxiety is not a mental illness to the degree that it puts you on the street. I'm sorry, I'm not buying into it. But you have to make choices. But if your choice is that you'd rather be someplace where you can do drugs whenever you want, wherever you want, then that also is your choice. but I shouldn't have to tolerate it. I shouldn't have to drive by that. Nobody in the city should have to drive by it. And then it kills me. Manchester Economic Development Office wants us to come up with a new slogan to attract people and businesses to the downtown area. Are you joking? Are you serious? Like, maybe you need to take the make it so that there aren't piles of people living on the sidewalks. I don't know how you do it, but we're paying somebody $100,000 a year plus benefits. Get on that.
And you know, so let's break it down a little bit in terms of so when we say tolerate, right? So that's a nice word for how we feel about it. But then there's also policy. Mm. And policy is, what are we doing? Like, do we have the right solutions in place? So tolerate can be equivalent to subsidize if you're looking at a government program, right? Because if you're subsidizing it, then you're saying, oh, I guess this is okay.
This is because, what we get.
Because the economic rule is whatever you subsidize,
gets worse.
You get more of.
Yep.
That is a immutable economic rule. You can quibble, you can fight, but like gravity, it's the truth. So if we are subsidizing this behavior, then we're going to get more of it. How do I know? Because 5 years ago, I told you if we subsidize this behavior, we will get more of it. And now we do.
We've always had some homeless. I get that.
No, honestly, when I moved to New Hampshire 14, 15 years ago,
it wasn't like this.
There were no panhandlers.
No, there was definitely no panhandlers.
Like, forget about, like, you know, homeless tents and homeless camps and whatever. And then what happened? We got all touchy feely and we were like, oh. Now, again, it's not a lack of compassion. Here is the hard nuts, folks. If you, homeless person, do not value your own life, because you're using drugs or so messed up.
Or you just can't be bothered.
You know, the unemployment rate is incredibly low. Right. I actually saw a meme the other day. I'm sure it was a joke, but it was like a homeless guy standing next to a Walmart guy with a now hiring sign. And the other guy was like, we'll work for food.
Right.
And,
but
you know,
not
and,
really.
And so it's like, there's a story that's being told here. But at the heart of this story is the individual. And the question becomes, who are you, homeless person, a nameless, faceless, homeless person, and what is your excuse?
Right.
Like, you got because to I do get, think- like, there's so much money going into this problem that I'm sorry, the real issue boils down to every one of those people as an individual. And we have to stop, like, glossing over
right.
it and whatever.
And
like,
say,
we should have a panel and make them come in one at a time.
Tell me your problem.
And justify.
Show me why you're living in the tent. And if you come in and you come in and we can determine
see
that you're actually mentally ill and you really can't figure out how to, like, live. So, okay.
So,
you go in that line.
So why wasn't our homeless
coordinator,
Nazi
subsidizer, whatever.
Doing that, because we sometimes would go for coffee at Bake before it shut down because of the government's response to COVID. And we would see there was a guy who would come in, he had a clipboard and he'd bring in some homeless guy and they'd sit there and, you know, the guy would have his suitcase and he'd ask him all these questions. And it was actually really curious. I was like trying to hear,
like, what are they asking?
Because it's like, and it was literally like, how can we fulfill your needs more?
That's what it's like.
And I'm like,
and that's what, and
maybe your needs need to not
and
be.
Back to that media bias, that's what we're telling people. If we would just have more compassion and we could just help them. And I see more, all I see
you can't
over
help people
year
who
after
won't
year,
help themselves.
What I'm seeing more and more is people looking for someone else to help them. Not to help them, for someone else to do. And it I have not always had the easiest life. Like, you traveled across the world to live here. I can appreciate being in bad circumstances.
Honestly, I've been addicted to drugs.
Right.
I was an alcoholic.
Right.
You at some stage have to
decide.
Make some choices and be like, well, is this really like the future? Like, you know, I mean, I was like a fancy.
No, but I agree. You made a choice that
but
I'm
I
no
was
longer
like, oh,
drink because I would like this instead of this.
Right.
So
and so it's not easy. And I'm like, okay, but come on, man.
Because
if
I'll be
honest, do it, you can do
while
it.
You were away, it was like the week before Thanksgiving, and I just find myself shaking. I on all the social media, on Facebook, on Nextdoor, all I seem I seem to see is people saying, where do I go to get the free turkey? Where do I go to get presents for my kids? Where do I go to get the free this? Well, who's giving out the free that? And I thought, when did it become, nothing's free. So when did it become, in order for you to have Thanksgiving dinner, I have to donate so that you don't have to pay for it?
And look, I'm a big proponent of private charity, I am right? Too. So because that's a voluntary exchange. But in the same way we're subsidizing thereby creating more bad behavior, we also have to,
there's got to be a point where people have to be responsible for themselves before I have to be responsible for them.
So part of our malaise as a society is this notion of we've internalized this idea of everyone's a victim, right? Mm. And so it's like, oh, boo hoo hoo. And it's like, no, change comes from you, from inside you. So if you are like the programs have to empower that energy, right? Instead of the handout of a energy Band-Aid. It's got to be like, can we Tony Robbins these guys, right? You know, like,
how can we hey Pete, what do you need in life to change? Well, I need some place to sleep so I can take a shower because I have a job. Fine, put Pete in that column. Susie, what do you need? Well, I don't need anything because I'm a drug addict and I don't want to stop taking drugs. Okay, well, you go in a completely different pile. You're like, right. I'm sorry.
Right. And honestly, at least having that conversation, because I think, you know, some junkies actually have to admit that to themselves.
I think
they have to go, right. Actually, no, that's my choice. Right. I want to live on the street I want to do drugs.
In that article that was in the Union Leader the other day, there was Sonny, because they were talking about how there were numbers used. Right. And somebody said there was 160 homeless people in Manchester. And then this other advocate guy said, well, it's actually probably closer to 1,000. And even the person in the article goes, yeah, that's probably not the case. But, yeah, it was Mark Hayward, I think, in that too. And it was like, that's probably not a real number. So they
think the numbers we're seeing, the people we see are the people we see. Right. So we know there are these enclaves at the bus station, at the New Horizons, that kind of stuff. I know that the parks are clear on the west side now because the leaves have come down. So you can see the various camps and they're all empty. So, you know, it's just the reality is you get what you tolerate. Yep. And so I think, you know, as Granite Staters and as Manchkins who are paying property taxes.
My taxes went up.
That went up. Then, you know what, Mayor Craig and your cohorts, like, you gotta solve this problem. Yep. We're done.
On a lighter note, while we have a minute left, I do want to say that there is on Queen City News and Alerts, and also what's going on in Manchester Community News and Alerts Facebook pages, there is a list of 2022 Christmas lights. I'm going to retype the Manchester ones and put it on our Manch Talk Facebook page, because if you're like me and you like to see Christmas lights, I would like to be able to have a list of where I can go. I will include the other towns, or especially like our adjoining towns, the ones that are next
to us. I still have to put up my one tree thing of Christmas lights.
You know, whatever.
Which are just white and very plain, but I'm going to do it.
On there, because I wish somebody would just build an interactive map, and if I can figure out how to do that, I will, but I don't think I can because I'm not that
can have Christmas
savvy.
Lights and drop a pin for a homeless person.
I used to like the idea of following behind the trolley tour for the seniors, because then you could just follow their trip, right? But I never seem to find out when it is, and I Googled it this morning, and it was this past weekend, and I'm like, it's too early for the trolley tour, and I did look at that, and every year it used to be later, so there's the city not knowing what to do. Let's have trolley tour like closer to Thanksgiving, you know. Anyways, that's all we've got for the week. We're running out of time. If you have any questions or suggestions or hate mail or love mail or whatever it is, email us at manchtalk@gmail.com. And meanwhile, I will post this list and hopefully everything will go smooth and we'll be back next Tuesday to tape again. Have a wonderful weekend. Enjoy the warm weather.
Take care, guys.
Bye.
Bye. We'll be right back.